If you're to go to any bistro French restaurant, there's a good chance you're going to find beef tartare on the menu, because that's a staple in those kind of venues. But you know what? With the right preparation, you could actually make it at home with a fraction of the cost. And I'm going to show you how to do it today on the Wandering Yuki Cheese Cafe. Yeah, sometimes you get lucky, sometimes you're not so lucky at all. I did say in an earlier episode this year that I feel like I had one or two seasons left of this barbecue, but after doing a few sessions over here, the interior is really starting to get even more rotten than I expected. Like, it's starting to, I knew there was rust, but the fact it's chipping apart, I'm losing my support for all of the charcoal grills and etc. means that I might have to replace this thing a little bit quicker than I anticipated. So, I kind of feel like that at least I'm going to be going out with a bang and sharing with the respect it deserves. So, welcome to another edition of the Wandering Yuki Cheese Cafe. It's Friday, it's beautiful outside, and I want to do some preparation for another meal. But I wasn't going to be doing the grilling because I did do a surprise grilling earlier in the week, and I thought as much as I would enjoy a steak or something else, I didn't want to overdo such a good thing, and also I wasn't feeling inspired to do any charring. But I thought, I show off beef tartare a lot, and the last time I really showed you how to do it from start to finish on camera was my very first attempt when I want to say that I was possessed by some demons, ghosts, or... Yeah, I guess I was looking like Monster Mash about to pledge my allegiance to do the graveyard smash, so there you go. If you do want to see that, I'm just going to say click the card in the top right corner and you can revisit Halloween 2023. Which is funny to think about considering that I'm about 4 months away from Halloween. I keep talking about the passage of time, and here we are already in the middle of June. Whatever the case, it's been a little while. I've had a little bit of practice slip for myself the last few months since I first did that episode, and I thought it's a pretty good summer meal, and it's something that's pretty easy to do with minimal prep work. There is some prep, but you can do it in a relatively quick amount of time with some precautions for sure. So we're gonna be doing that today. And before I jump into that, here's my suggestion. Hit that subscribe button below and put your notification bell on. That way, if there's a new video that's gonna be ready for viewing, you're gonna get a pop-up on your phone. Plus, give me a thumbs up right away. I know you haven't watched the full episode, but fuck it, like it. The more likes I get, the more you help me get promoted all across YouTube. And we'll see, maybe I could be on TikTok one day. I do have some followers that say they want to see the Wandering Yuki on TikTok, but that's a story probably for another time. And because I am outside and it's a Friday, I do need a brew for myself. Now. Okay. So, a banana bowl, banana beer, and it's kind of crazy stuff to think about because this is one that seemed to have appeared out of nowhere for me, and I knew by the name of it I'd want to give it a shot. It's from the Fifth Baron Brewery. Where is this located again? Rue Principale? Oh, that's like French for like a main street. When you go to a lot of the rural areas of or suburb areas of Quebec, you're gonna find like a rue principale, which is where all the businesses are, and then a whole bunch of residential. In Aylmer, I actually don't know where that is, but I have to look at the map again. But this is a New England IPA that I thought was pretty awesome, and I had to get that just for the name. There's always money in the banana stand. I think clearly whoever was coming up with the name of this was probably watching an episode of Arrested Development, and that was like one of their like repeated jokes from the entire series. That's one of my favorite shows of all time. It's so off the wall. The whole thing was filmed like a mockumentary. There's like callbacks to previous jokes and also call forwards to jokes or things that are going to be coming up in the future episode that you're only going to pick up on like if you rewatch it again. Again, it was a bloody brilliant show. It's too bad it got canceled quickly. It did come back on Netflix for a fourth season, but I don't really know what that one is like. All I do know is that the first three seasons that were aired on Fox are classics to this day. And if you haven't watched it, well, what are you waiting for? Just go to it. So this is a New England IPA, which you could tell just by the color, the texture, and the atmosphere of it. I'm not sure if I smell the banana in here yet, but I guess we'll give it a shot. So I am gonna give you a little cheers. That's an appropriate trophy. So I got to interrupt it previously. I mean, I got to interrupt on my cheers, all because of a fucking trophy. Tasty. It doesn't really have much of a banana taste. Like, it's probably there, very subtle. I'm just gonna have to let it sit on my tongue for a bit more so I can let it digest. Not a bad beer to start off a Friday, even if it's a bit of a silly one, Doc. Still don't have too much of a banana taste. It's very subtle, I would say, at best, but it's not very overpowering. Because when I think banana, I think like banana liquors you can get, which are pretty powerful, or banana popsicles, banana slushes from back when I was a kid. Those tasted more like banana, even though it was like natural, artificial banana flavor, but that's besides the point. Oh yeah, I got the carrot top over here. Well, I know what I gotta do. It's been a while since I chucked stuff from my deck. Anyways, moving on to more important stuff. Beef tartare. I probably told this story in the past before, but it bears repeating because I know I got some new viewers since I've done those episodes. My main point of reference of beef tartare was seeing, obviously, that Mr. Bean episode from like the early 90s, where he orders steak tartare at this fancy French restaurant. He served it, but then he's disgusted to see it. It's basically a raw burger that he was served. Tries to eat it, he doesn't like it, and he's trying to hide it everywhere on his table, like under napkins, in the butterbell, I think he put it down the waiter's shirt or pants, if I'm not mistaken. It's been a while since I watched that episode, but one of these days I'll revisit it. And then of course I kind of got used to it, because first time I did try it out was Nick's Bistro in February 2019. Nick's is a, if it sounds familiar to you, it's because I was there recently when I documented it. I'm going to put a card in the top right corner for you to watch to revisit that. When I did a starter pint at Piranha Bar, went there because my original plan of going to the ninth floor of Eaton's just didn't pan out. But that's where I first had it, and I thought, okay, this isn't so bad at all. Because once you get past the raw calwa element of that, it's pretty tasty. Of course, if you're going to be doing this at home, there are some precautions you'll need to take, and there's certain instructions, certain cuts of meat, certain types of meat you really shouldn't use when you're doing that, because you're just going to end up getting sick. And that's what I'm going to be here to show you today. So without further ado, we're going to move on to our ingredients. I have your container I'm going to use for mixing, giant bowl to put all the meat and the seasoning in. Funny, I could have sworn I had more stuff when I came out with this. What a bizarre turn of events that was. Like, usually I come prepared with all my ingredients when I do these vlogs, but somehow I ended up doing a little bit of a treasure hunt around my backyard. Not like a Legend of Zelda style. I did like the Ronnie Griffith I was playing, so talk about like a one-hit wonder disco song. I'm good with that. But your ingredients for putting together your tartare are pretty straightforward. And there's a pretty good chance you're gonna have all of these already in your pantry. So we're gonna just get right on to this and I'll show you exactly what you gotta do. And there's gonna be some alternatives you'll find on the internet, but this is just my preferred recipe and you'll probably find ways that work best for you as well. So, first thing you're gonna need here is some plain old Dijon mustard, but instead, unlike my Bavette steak that I've done before, where I use maybe a tablespoon worth, this you're only gonna need like maybe, depending on your serving size, like half a teaspoon, maybe even like, oh, you know what, I'm just gonna put a little bit extra in here because of the size of the meat that I'm gonna have. So there we go. And then you're gonna need another type of mustard too that I probably shown off before. It's one that I only really started buying this past year when I was doing my beef tartare recipes at home. It's something that's called, oof, I actually saw some fumes come out of this thing. So old-fashioned mustard is a little bit like Dijon mustard, but the big difference is that this stuff here is gonna be ground up into a little bit of a paste, whereas this one is the mustard seed mixed in with liquids, and you're gonna have all the mustard seeds here. And this is actually the main part of your ingredients that you're gonna be using. I like to use like a little bit of a half a heaping tablespoon when I'm putting this together, because recipes I've seen online say you could use, you know, tablespoon, two tablespoons of this, one teaspoon of Dijon mustard. But the reality is that that's really made for recipes that are cooking like a full pound of meat altogether. Because I'm the only one that likes to have beef tartare amongst my immediate family, I'm the only one that really makes it. So I gotta factor in that I'm only doing one serving at a time. So that's why I would use only half a tablespoon of this. And for the amount of meat I'm using, it's just a perfect amount because I don't wanna make it too liquidy. First time I ever encountered this, I think was at, I feel like it was at La Mer à Boire, a nice pub that's over on St. Denis Street within the Latin quarters of Montreal, where I had that with a homemade pretzel and dipped it into this jalapeno mustard sauce. If you wanna see that, I'm gonna put a link on the top right corner for you to revisit, because I did go there and went to L'Express for some octopus, which I was told has one of the best wine menus around the city. It's funny how you learn these things. But this is me dipping the stuff there, and this is me mixing this to kind of combine with others. I kind of wonder what this is like on its own. I don't know, am I crazy enough to do this? I made a huge mistake. I rinsed it out, great. Actually no, who am I kidding? It's not the worst tasting thing. It's just not very often you see people having a spoonful of mustard like that. But you're talking to a guy who, when he was like 6-7 years old, he would have a bowl full of icing sugar just because. I don't know what was up with me back then. Whatever the case, I'm gonna be moving along. Olive oil is gonna be your next ingredient. And I've seen recipes where they say like use like 2 tablespoons, 3 tablespoons worth, but I'm just eyeballing this so that it mixes up with here. Because the idea is that you just want to blend this up with the rest of your stuff. Then next is going to be some capers. Capers, I've had it a number of times over the years, most likely in a smoked salmon sandwich, because apparently those two things, along with cream cheese, go pretty well, like peanut butter and jelly. Or peanut butter and chocolate, if you're a Reese's Pieces fan, because I love that shit too, but I'd like to have chocolate. And other times I've seen they use like maybe a couple of tablespoons of this stuff, but I would really need a handful. Like, I would say, hang on, let's just keep going. I would say that this is gonna be the equivalent of maybe a teaspoon worth. For my intents and purposes, it's perfect. Oh yeah, these things are from Spain too, so got the Spanish love to this day. Just like my fridge of a Madrí imitation Spanish beer, my love of jamón serrano, and etc. I did have to laugh though, because I was looking at the sodium content here, because that's something I'm kind of conscious about these days, and they say it has 680 milligrams worth for every cup. This thing has 100 milliliters, so I don't know how you can get a full cup out of this. And if you need to have a full cup of, 30 grams, like if you have to have a full cup of this, I don't know, it seems like a lot for one sitting. But that's just me oozing a little bit. What I'm gonna do now is just dice these up. I don't wanna be too picky about it. Oop, hang on, what's going on? Ah, don't mind me, I had some text messages coming in. Here I thought there was like somebody trying to call me. It is Friday, you know, I'm off the clock. So once these are all cut up, just add them into the mixture. There. And there you go. And then the next thing you can do is just grab yourself a tablespoon and start combining it all together. There are a few other ingredients you could probably add to this too, like salt and pepper for taste. But again, salt, pepper, especially the salt, it's already in here, so you don't really need to do that. There you go. So mix it all up, and then it's gonna become a little mixture like this in your little bowl. And you can keep that aside for a little bit later. But there's something else I can prepare too while I'm outside, because I will have to manage some meat very soon. And yes, I was carrying an onion on my belt. Somehow I just had to go alakazam, and it appeared. I don't know, but onions on my belt? I guess I can eventually say it was a style at the time if people are looking at my videos decades down the road. But it's not really a yellow onion like, you know, the ones you probably think of when you're making chicken soup. What I got were shallots. So they're dry shallots, or as they say in French, échalote française. It's another case where the translation just doesn't match when you're trying to do a one-to-one. So dry shallots becomes échalote française. It's a little bit like shepherd's pie in English becomes pâté chinois in French, or technically Chinese pie, if you're to do a literal translation. But me, that's me rambling again. These things are actually pretty good when you're putting it with tartare for other sandwiches. And the beauty is, unlike your standard issue onions, they're actually very mild. So if you take a bite out of them directly raw, you don't want to cry your eyes out like you're hearing doves cry. So I'm just gonna do a full one, because I've seen some shallots are so big that you're gonna want to use half of them. This one is so small that I feel like I can get away with doing the full one and I'm not gonna notice a difference, especially because I'm gonna have so many other ingredients to mix up together. Okay, so the idea here is you just wanna dice up as much as possible. Some of them are gonna be hard to do, but that's fine. It's not perfection, because if you're the only one eating it, you don't have to worry about it being like perfection or super presentable. You can still make it presentable when it's not perfect too. But unlike the other ingredients, what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna move it into the larger mixing bowl here, because I think this is gonna work best when I get to the later step. There we go. We got our onions, we got our sauce put aside. You know what, I might have one idea for another ingredient I could put in. It's something that I remember reading quickly, I saw cornichon could be one of them, and I thought, well, why not? I got a whole bunch of them here. So what I'm doing is I'm taking the pickle, a homemade pickle, and I'm gonna dice up and then add it into my mix. Yes, I do have also a video for making this at home, and click the top right corner. It's very straightforward. You just need to get some cucumber, garlic, vinegar, salt, water, some dill, whether it's fresh dill or if it's gonna be like dill seeds, that works well. And then you can add some pickling spice if you want also. So I'm just gonna take a few slices of this and then we'll vat. I am hungry and I like pickles, so I gotta put them to use. Yeah, this is gonna be my creative touch for today. There, my pickles are finally put together. So now that I have all this cut up, the next step is gonna be getting the meat all set up so that it's ready for handling and combine it with all the rest of this stuff. So I'm just gonna take a quick intermission to prepare my meat. I won't show you that stuff. And what I wanna say is I won't show you exactly how I'm doing it. I'll just explain when I come back, so stay tuned. We'll be right back. Here we are, everybody. I've got some stuff working in the oven inside, and my cow is all prepared, so that means it's time to prepare the tartare. So I'm sure this is gonna be the big question for someone who's not familiar. How exactly is it safe to have beef tartare, which is essentially raw beef? Well, there's a couple of things you gotta keep in mind is the preparation. Your first thing you gotta remember is you gotta get your meat fresh. Like, go to a butcher, even a high quality grocery store that has like AAA meat, and then they can cut you up the piece just as you need it. Just be sure to specify you use it for tartare so they know what they're doing. And as for why raw beef is easy to eat, here's why. Because all of your surface germs, like all of your germs are gonna be on the surface, so microbes, bacteria is all gonna be on the top. Microbes cannot penetrate beef at all because the flesh is so dense. Unlike with chicken where it's so soft, you're actually gonna be able to have the germs, microbes, or bacteria all penetrating into the flesh. And that's how you can get sick. And it's also especially because of how you can get salmonella with it. Pork, it's also too soft, and you know you're gonna get some parasites and other sicknesses if you try to eat that raw. So keep that in mind too. So it's basically beef that you can do raw. And I usually like to do another kind of preparation I read about. Some say you can do it, eat it right away if you get it fresh. But what I like to do to be safe is I like to get my meat, dip it in boiling salt water for about 10 seconds, and then transfer it into that bowl of cold water too to change the temperature. Because the way that works here is that once you put together, like once you boil that, the salt water disinfects the top, the bottom, the sides, so that the interior is gonna be safe enough for consumption. That's how you could do a steak, medium rare, or even rare for yourself, because once you, I can't really talk. It is Friday after all. But once you sear that, then you're able to, you know, consume it properly. That's probably how you could also do your own burgers if you want to grind up and do your own burgers like raw or like medium rare. And you're probably thinking like, yeah, you're boiling it. But when you look at the piece of meat here, it is kind of brown. It's superficial because I guess this is a good way to show it. I'm just gonna give this a cut. Just give it a few slices and there you go. So, I don't know if it's easy to see on camera, but when you look over here, you're seeing that the inside of the meat is still raw. So the outside portion, you're only looking at the surface of it. We're talking about an eighth of an inch at best, maybe even a 16th of an inch or a 32nd of an inch if you wanna talk about, you know, construction terms. So what you do then is once this is all cooled up, it's easy to manipulate, and then you just have to slice up like this into small strips, and then you dice up further, and then you can mix it in with the rest of that. And I know some of you are thinking like, wow, that's not real tartare, but it's one of the techniques I've seen. Other techniques will probably say that you can just put it in the freezer. Other ones will say get it sliced fresh right away and make it right away. It all depends. This is just the way that I personally prefer to do it, because that's the one I feel the most safe with. Essentially though, I'll slice up, I'll dice it up, throw it into the big bowl here, then I'm gonna mix in my Dijon seasoning and then leave in the fridge until my other stuff is gonna be all set to go. Oh yeah, there's also one other thing I'm gonna do too is adding this Louisiana hot sauce. Because if you go to restaurants, a lot of places are gonna ask, do you want yours regular or spicy? I know I have my uncle who likes to get it spicy. Other people like to get it too just to get the kick. It's all depending on your preference, because this thing is really a flavor as opposed to a heavy spice, which is the way that I prefer this. Oh yeah, all this ramble about raw meat, I forgot that I'm out of a brew here. And luckily, I have a good one here from the Brasa du Moulin, or the Miller's Brewer. And I picked it up because of the name too, Douce Caroline, and they're saying it's supposed to be a Blonde du Richelieu. So I'm guessing right by the Richelieu River over here. I don't know what is specific about a Richelieu blonde versus a standard issue blonde or like maybe a St. Lawrence blonde, but I got it because of the name of the label here. Douce Caroline essentially seems like it translates roughly to Sweet Caroline. So just like the other one where I feel like they're a fan of Arrested Development, whoever named this here up in Varennes, Okay, it's not too far from where I live, but whoever named this is clearly a Neil Diamond fan. You know, he's a classic, like one of those that my mom used to listen to when she was growing up, or even also played in the house before.
Where it began, I can't begin to knowing, but then I know it's growing strong. Wasn't the spring, and spring became the summer. Who'd have believed you'd come along? Hand, touching hands, reaching out, touching me, touching you. Fill it up with only two. And when I hurt, hurting runs off my shoulders. How can I hurt when holding you? Warm, touching warm.
Okay, so that's actually the one downside of working with raw meat, is that every time you want to do stuff, you got to always rewash it if you want to use other utensils. And also, especially because I am working with a camera, I got to be mindful not to infect all the other stuff here. So I got my meat all set up here, covered by the cutting board, because I did have some flies hanging around it because I guess they're attracted to it. And, oh, I moved my mustard like an idiot. Give me a second. God dang it. Getting to work with this shit. There's always money in the banana stand, my ass. Oh, right. It's a wireless mic. People get to hear me talking shit even when I'm not on camera. Oh well, it is what it is. But anyways, my meat's all ground up over here. Then I have it with the shallot and the pickle mixture here. So then the next step is to take my Dijon mustard mix, and then, oh yeah, it's mixed with the capers also, and then just throw it inside. Just like so. And don't want to have to worry about having it too liquidy, because the idea is that you just want enough mustard and oil so that it binds everything together. So then once you're good, you're just going to mix it, and then this mustard's going to help it stick and condense into a little like mini burger, for lack of a better term. So that's how you're going to be doing that. You know, of all the things that's in here, it's the pickle scent that's really hitting me right now. So that's actually a brand new ingredient I put in here, so I'm kind of stoked to see how that turns out. And I have some residual onion also, but that's fine. I'll just keep mixing it until it's all blended in. You're going to take note too that I also put in the Louisiana sauce in the meat, so that means it's already going to be spicy. I'm going to combine it all together. There we go. Okay, this is actually a little bit more... There's a lot more going on here than I expected, but essentially when you look at this, here's how the tartare looks. There's a lot more vegetables in here because of the shallots and also because of the pickle in here, but whatever. It's something brand new, and it's Friday. I just want to enjoy myself and show something brand new on camera. So once this is all mixed up to the best of its abilities, what you're going to do then is you're going to keep it inside in the fridge, because you want to keep this stuff cool before you're ready to serve it. In terms of how long you can keep it for, well, once this is all cut up and then prepared like this, you basically have to serve it right away to be able to still eat it raw. If you leave it too long, like maybe till the next day,
you are going to have to cook it because bacteria is going to be building up in there. That's something to keep in mind. And again, it's a reason that I only had to prepare enough for one serving, because I know that I am going to have to be the only one eating this. Now, in terms of the serving size, I did a 1/4 pound, like just a little bit more than that, because I find for me, that's the perfect amount of meat. And I'm not talking about the, yeah, no mad clown policy. Fuck you, Ronald. I find that 100 grams is just enough for me for this. So I'll put this in the fridge, and then I'm going to be right back once the fries are all set up.
All right, I almost forgot. There was one pretty important detail that I wanted to bring up about my steak. So some of you are probably thinking, like, if it's safe to do, what's the best kind of cut that you can use when you're making your own tartare? Well, based on what I've read online, a lot of people will suggest you could use beef tenderloin, aka filet mignon, for that. And that was actually the first cut that I bought when I did tartare for the first time at home. But the reality is that you really don't have to do that at all. You could go for something a little less expensive than that. I found that top sirloin, inside round steak, top round, like those are the kind of cuts you can use. And you're gonna be able to do that at a fraction of the cost. If you want an example, if you're living in Canada, about the prices, 100 grams of filet mignon is gonna be about 10 bucks, probably more or less, depending on where you get it, if it's on sale, versus if I'm getting top sirloin or sirloin tip, or even inside round, like that's gonna be maybe 3-4 bucks for 100 grams. So you get it for less than half the price of it. And honestly, when you're cutting it up and you have it all in this here, then it's gonna be pretty tender. I think personally speaking, my own apprehension towards that would have been just because I remember we grew up a lot with these inside round pepper steaks. I'm sure you've seen those before where the edge of it is all covered in a lot of pepper, and we always got the thin cut, and it was always cut, like cooked so well done to the point that it was kind of chewy, kind of rough, and you need to have it with ketchup. It's one of those things I learned later in life that you kind of have to do steak medium rare to get it done properly, because when you do it that way, you don't need ketchup at all, because you got it naturally juicy, the seasonings all make it really worthwhile. So that's the final result. But that is all a little bit of a sidetrack, because I just wanted to bring that up once again. So I have a little bit of a nice setup here. I did some baguette sliced up with a bit of olive oil, a little bit of fries done in the oven, which I've done before. This one's essentially just olive oil, garlic, oregano, and paprika, because apparently a paprika is a big thing when you're making fries for yourself. Traditionally, if it's gonna be in a restaurant, you get either with fries or salad. Very few of them are actually gonna be serving it with both of them together. One of the only spots I ever got it from that had both was at Beaufort Bistro. It was in Plaza Saint-Hubert. And the sad thing is that place closed down end of last year, so it means I'm never gonna be able to go back to that. And it's too bad because they also have my favorite IPs in Nord-Est. But I digress, because right now, once I have this all cooled up, I have it on the plate, and then, oops, let's just make sure I don't tip anything over, because I wanna make sure it's all prepared for the camera. There you go, beef tartare for the win. And here we are. So once again, a beef tartare meal fit for a king. I got my baguette and a bit of olive oil. I also got some fries made homemade that are pretty awesome. The paprika and the fresh garlic really hit you on the spot. But obviously you're not here to see the fries, you're here to see the taste test of the tartare. So naturally when you're eating this, you're gonna be given these pieces of toast, which could be baguette, it could be like also tortillas, I've seen pita bread, or even like corn chips. Like I've seen just about everything in all these restaurants. And then what you would do is just take a small portion of it, serve it right on top, and then you just eat it as is, like so. And, you know, I've had this countless times, but the pickle really gives it a nice taste. That reminds me, I should take a picture of this so I could show a couple of friends what I'm putting together. There we go. So breaking the fourth wall right now. This is pretty awesome. And this is a bit thicker than you might find in some restaurants, because I've been to some restaurants where their tartare is going to be ground up almost like a puree after they probably prepare to do what they got to do. Meat, it's just easy to do into small little chunks of it and then serve it on this. This is good stuff. Great meal. One of my favorite things to do at home when I don't know what to prepare for supper. It's simple, straightforward, and it's only a fraction of the cost than if you're going to be in a restaurant. Not to take away from the restaurant, because for a while, I used to go to a restaurant because I never knew how to do this and didn't trust myself. But the way they prepare it sometimes, with the vibe, sometimes the brews, it's always a thing of beauty. But I'm just going to enjoy this beer, enjoy the supper, and if someone's looking and thinking, where's the vegetable? I got Brussels sprouts I'm going to be tackling very soon. But before I do that, thanks for watching this latest edition of the Waranuki Cheese Cafe. If you like what you see, you know what to do. Hit that subscribe button below. Give me a thumbs up if you enjoy my antics, my wanders, my stories, and everything that comes with this. And if you have any ideas for future episodes, leave it in the comments. I'll see what I could do. Till then, take care. See you next time. Can I actually cheers everybody now? Come on, I already got that trophy. If you play a PlayStation game, you don't get a trophy twice.